Good morning, everyone. I'm the Reverend Jake Joseph, coming to you from the offices of First Church Guilford, because our sanctuary is about 100 degrees today. Let us be together in worship.
And here is our scripture passage for this morning from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 7. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all people do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the rules of the elders, and they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites. As it is written, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." May God grant us wisdom and understanding of this passage.
Thank you, Penelope. One of my favorite biblical scholars, Dr. Mary Ann Tolbert, is emerita professor of the Pacific School of Religion, or PSR, a UCC seminary in Berkeley, California. In addition to founding the LGBTQ and gender studies at PSR, she's also one of the foremost experts on the Gospel according to Mark, our reading for today. She published a book in 1986 that was republished in 1996 called Sowing the Gospel. And in it, she goes into great detail to help her readers understand the context, the complexities, the uncertainty, and the dramatic changes and fear in the world Jesus lived in. Tolbert concludes her 1986 book by writing, "In a period beset by Star Wars, nuclear weapons, acid rain, widespread famine, revolution, and war, today in our world, we might add, pandemic, racism, increasing of hate groups, and climate change, Mark's analysis of the human world seems like clear-eyed realism. By observing institutions and universities and churches to corporations and governments around the globe, we can easily testify to the power wealth, status, fame, and authority have to still corrupt humanity and harden hearts to the suffering of others." Tolbert speaks truth that sounds like it was written for Sunday, August 29th, 2021. But she continues with hope and an action step. I like any theologian who actually gives us an action step. She says, "Mark's analysis should be valued, but Christians and people today must work not individually, but in solidarity with others to bring to fruition this abundant and lovingly created vineyard that is God's intended realm, earth. Our alternative may well be Mark's other vision of the future from chapter 13, verse 19, quote, such tribulation as has not been from the beginning of the creation, which God created until now and never will be. We have the power to become responsible tenants or to destroy the vineyard absolutely. Which is it to be?" Again, one of the foremost experts on Mark concludes the reflection on this passage saying, "We have the power to become responsible tenants or to destroy the vineyard absolutely. Which is it to be?" Today we're back to basics, to the basic questions. What are we doing here? How are we communicating? What matters in life, and what relevant thing do we have to say as Christians, as representatives of institutional religion, for living and surviving in 2021? Tolbert offers it in one phrase, solidarity with others. How do you say it? What are you doing here? Turns out, according to scholarship, the Pharisees were absolutely accurate. They were right, according to the mandates of the time. They were the public health officials and experts of the day. The disciples were wrong, according to the mandates, the best practices of the town. Why then is Jesus so upset? Why can't Jesus hear their good advice? You should thoroughly wash produce you buy from the market and wash your hands before eating and wash your silverware. But shaming the disciples and Jesus publicly on social media, on the town's Facebook pages, wasn't necessarily the communal or kind or effective way, or even human way, to help them understand that they were out of line with the community, best practices, and local mandates. Especially in the ancient world, before modern medicine, every day was like living within the space of a pandemic. Washing hands before eating wasn't just ritual, but basic common sense. Notice in this story that Jesus does not disagree with the substance of what the establishment is saying to his followers. But he has an issue with the hypocrisy and the hierarchy. Let's be honest. Come on, let's be honest now. How many of you, and please don't raise your hands out there in the audience, because I already know the answer, and you too, if you're honest with yourselves, haven't broken any rules or guidelines or mandates all throughout the pandemic? You didn't take your mask off that one time while you were walking outside last April? You didn't sneak a visit with your grandparents before everyone was vaccinated? It was you who hoarded all that toilet paper at Costco, wasn't it? I know you. I like to say that the pandemic has turned everyone into somewhat of Jesus' favorite nickname, a hypocrite and a judge. Just if we can admit it or not. It doesn't mean that we should stop our efforts at calling people out when necessary to be better or do better, or even ourselves. But it does mean as we go into this second winter of pandemic, our tone may need to change in order to be effective communicators, unlike the Pharisees, and humble in the face of our own hypocrisies. William Barclay, 20th century Scottish-British scholar, once wrote about this story in the Bible. The establishment, the Pharisees, the health officials, saw that the disciples of Jesus did not observe the niceties of tradition and the code of oral law in regard to washing their hands before and during meals. And so Jesus points out the big picture of hypocrisy and the value of putting people and spirituality first in conversation. Friends, here's my big picture. This year we've had and the years ahead are going to be messy. You will constantly be wrong and accidentally, or sometimes intentionally, hypocritical. Even as the saints of Guildford, I'm told that that's the name we fancied calling ourselves until recently at First Church. The ethics of the future are as murky as Long Island Sound after a late August algae bloom. Should I get a booster shot now when others, especially in less wealthy countries, haven't yet had access to shots? Do I wear a mask indoors in New Haven where it's required by mandate, but not in Milford or Guildford where it's not yet mandated? When or where is it okay to travel? Should I take my kids out of school if I disagree with the teacher? Should we go back to in-person worship, or should we stop in-person worship again? Do I not go back to the office if it risks my salary or my family? The questions are all existential. And regardless of the choice we make, the judgments and the unkindnesses from other humans will be public, swift, and frequently cruel. Ginger, most of the church leadership, and I acquiesced to the demands to reopen church in September of 2020, with safeguards and distancing, before almost any other UCC church did. Luckily, nobody that we know of became sick because of that decision. Regardless of whether it was right or wrong or somewhere in between, I will live with that decision for the rest of my career in local church ministry. September 2020. The what-ifs do haunt me still sometimes. Ministers are not alone in this ethical muddiness. On Tuesday this week, the executive editor of Slate magazine wrote an editorial article that knocked me off my feet with the long but accurate title of "My COVID Parenting Has Reached Peak Inconsistency." Honestly, I have no idea what I'm okay with letting my kids do anymore. Long title, but descriptive. She tells this story. A couple of days ago, my 12-year-old son peeked into my bedroom while I was working and asked if the new kid who moved in just down our block could come inside to play video games. Before I could answer, he followed up with the obvious next question: and does he need to wear a mask? Yes, he can come in, and no, he does not need to wear a mask. No rhyme or reason to that answer, it's just what came out of my mouth. A few minutes later, another head popped into the room. It was my husband asking if I had really said it was okay to have this new kid come over without a mask. Yes, that's what I told him, I replied, but I have no idea. Do whatever you think is best. I don't know, up to you. And then I turned back to my laptop. In the end, my husband asked if the kid was vaccinated, yes, and let him stay mask-free. But neither of us could really say why we made the decision we did, or if we'd make the same decision next time, or if any of our decisions add up to anything comprehensible at all. This is parenting, and I would add, ministering, these days for us and too many people we know. Peak inconsistency. Complete incoherence. Hypocrisy. Just decision after decision based on a little bit of science, a little bit of outdated guidance, and a little bit of how much energy we have to think it through. Just decision after decision based on a little bit of science, a little bit of outdated guidance, and a little bit of how much time or energy we have to think it through. In order to survive these days and spiritually thrive within it as a community of faith, we have to admit that we're the Pharisees. We have to admit to our own hypocrisy, our own peak inconsistency and complete incoherence, and move forward as best we can with love. Especially for those of you who are parents, I imagine you resonate with that article from Slate I just read. The Pharisees, often nicknamed by Jesus as the hypocrites, were actually right in this story. It is best for everyone if you wash your hands before a meal. Oral religious law based in ancient public health. So I think we are called today to ask how they could have nudged the disciples and Jesus to wash their hands or to wear their masks differently. How can we communicate with love first, knowing that in the course of all of this, we too will need reminders, and we too will have moments when we will be wrong and woefully inconsistent? I preached about in June during Pride Month how I turned to music as another way to uncover gospel and truth. I do the same for us today. Last week, I heard someone say that if you want to understand the needs, the dramas, the wants, the beliefs, the conflicts of any given time, simply listen and read the lyrics of the Billboard Top 20 hits. It's a crash course on sociology. Pick any date in history and listen to the lyrics and the conflicts and the subject matter of the music, and you'll get a sense of what the theology is. Theology just meaning theo or God, and ology, study or thinking. What is the big picture? What is the theology, the big picture idea we're wrestling with? It means what we believe in the bigger questions. Why are we here? What is my purpose? Why is there so much bad in the world? Why does love hurt us? How can love save us? This past week, all of the top 10 songs on Billboard's list were about love. The complexity of love, the failings of love, the need for love, the pain of love. Back to basics, lesson one, love. We are going to need a lot of love to survive this collectively and psychologically. By confessing our own hypocrisy, in working to be better communicators of mandates and boundaries, in learning how to live better with uncertainty. In all of it, we recommit to Jesus, who is love incarnate. Music reflects the theology of the soul, both spoken and words left unutterable deep in our hearts. So I leave you with my chosen anthem this summer, a song that has given me strength to love people and let that love change me. It is from a very unsuccessful musical by Sir Andrew Lloyd Webber called Aspects of Love. I don't recommend the whole musical, but I do recommend this song. The song Love, Love Changes Everything, has become gospel for me in the midst of my own hypocrisy and yours. Theology to me as I recenter for the long winter ahead. A winter where I hope we can just get back to the one basic of love. Love changes everything, hands and faces, earth and sky. Love, love changes everything, how you live and how you die. Love can make the summers fly or a night seem like a lifetime. Yes, love. Love changes everything. Now I tremble at God's name. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Love, love changes everything. Days are longer, words mean more. Love, love changes everything. Pain is deeper than before. Love will turn your world around, and that world will last forever. Yes, love. Love changes everything, brings you glory, brings you shame. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Off into the world we go, planning futures, shaping years. Love bursts in and suddenly all our wisdom disappears. Love makes fools of everyone. All the rules and mandates are broken. But love, love changes everyone. Live or perish in its flame. Love will never let you be the same.
Break the straw.